Hello and a hearty welcome to my channel. I welcome you all. Very good morning. I hope you all are keeping well. And so we are back again in our class. In the previous class, we had studied about mutability and immutability, and we had also seen which all are the various data types used in Python. So today we are going to see what are complex numbers and how they are stored in Python, what are variable internals, and we will also see a program to compute simple and compound interest. So let's move on. So here we are. We will be seeing firstly complex number arithmetic, secondly we will see variable internals, and third we will see a program to compute simple and compound interest. So let's start with the class. We first start with complex numbers. So in the memory, we know that complex numbers in Python are stored in this form a plus bj, where j represents I. So actually in Python, normally in electronic engineering, they work with the help of complex numbers, because they are working on complex electrical circuits, and hence they use this iota to represent electric current. And instead of I, they make use of j, hence Python follows this convention. Hence, in Python, complex numbers are represented in the form of a plus bj, where j represents the iota, which is exactly the value of I, that is under root minus 1, which represents imaginary number. Now, you might have studied in mathematics that complex numbers are numbers which cannot be solved using the equations or the formulas for which exist for real numbers. There exist many such numbers whose solution cannot be found out by using the techniques which are followed for real numbers. Hence, complex numbers are numbers which combine a real part and an imaginary part. So in a complex number, this part A represents the real part and this part B represents the imaginary part. And in Python also, we can represent them using floating point numbers, where if A and B are what? They are actually internally stored as floating point numbers. Because floating point numbers are immutable data types, hence A and B are also considered as complex numbers, also become what? They become your immutable data types. So now how complex numbers are represented in the memory. So let's move on to our Python idle over here. So here I'm going to represent a Python value like cnum, which represents a complex number, and I'm going to write 4.5 plus 3.32j. And now when I print this cnum, it will be printed as like this, 4.5 within brackets. So students, let me tell you one thing. I had provided this value over here, 4.5 plus 3.32j. So when the non-zero, when the real part is non-zero, the entire complex number is represented within brackets. And if suppose you are writing the when the real part is 0, then if you try to print the value of A, it will be giving you the imaginary part only without the bracket. Okay, because here the real part is 0. So this is one very important specification for complex numbers. Complex number arithmetic is also performed in a very easy way. That is, if I have two complex numbers like 2 complex numbers, so they will, and I want to perform an addition operation between them. So we know that real parts are added separately and imaginary parts are added separately. So here the sum will be 1 plus 2 and plus 4.2 plus minus 3.2j. That is 3 plus 4.2 minus 3.2j. That is, here I will be getting 1.0j. So this is going to be the value. So whatever is the sign, if suppose here I have minus sign, and here I have plus sign, so it will be considered as minus 4.2 plus 32j. 3 minus 4.2 plus 32j, that is like this. So instead of doing it this way, I can simply calculate it in this way. So 3 minus 1.0j. So this would be the answer. So this is how complex number arithmetic works. So let us check it out. I have CNUM2 and I am giving it the value as 1.5 plus 4j. And I write here CNUM plus CNUM2 and this is the answer which I get. So 4.5 plus 1.5 which gives me 6 and 3.32 plus 4 which gives me 7.32. That is 3 plus 4, 7.32j. So this is how complex number arithmetic is done in Python. So it's pretty simple. One more thing to remember, you can access the real and imaginary parts of complex numbers also. Like, please look here. It is, if I write cnum.real, it gives you the real part of cnum. And if you write cnum.imag, it will give you the imaginary part of the number. So real and imag, these are two properties which can be used to access the real and imaginary parts of complex numbers as well. Next is, we are going to see the variable internals. So variable internals consist of three things: value of the variable, the type of the variable object, and the ID, that is memory location. Value refers to the data which is stored in the variable. Type refers to the data type of the object stored in the memory which is being pointed by the variable. And ID refers to the memory address of the object. Because in Python, everything is stored in the form of an object. If I create an integer also, then integer object will be created in the memory to which this variable would be pointing. So variable merely acts as a label. So this object will have a data type, that is integer. So that would be its type. It would be having an address, that would be its ID, and it would be having a label which will be used to access its value. So this data which is stored, that refers to the value. So I will Just move on to the Python IDLE to show you how we can check. I write a equals 3.54, which is a float value. So here the value, if I want to print the value, I will simply write print a, which is giving me the value of the variable. So I'll write print value of a is equal to what a. So this gives me the value. If I want to print its type, so I will write type of a. I will write it like this. Within the type function, I will use a type function to check what which class it belongs to. So you can see the answer you get it is in this form, that is class float. So class float means, because in Python everything is saved in the form of an object. An object is a part of a class. So hence the class is actually the data type which is being represented over here. So the data type here is what? Float. So for any data type, like for example, I write here message msg equals hello, and I write here type msg. So this will return str, which shows that it is a string. So in the same way, you can have you can create a variable and you can get its data type. Now the next is your ID. So if I write ID A, so this is the ID, that is, this is the memory address where the object A has been created. Similarly, if I write ID STR, this is the memory address of STR. So why? Because normally string is what? It is a collection of variables. So now every variable will be having these three things: value, type and ID. To check the value, simply print the name, use the label, that is the variable name. To check its type, use the type function, and to check its memory location, use the ID function. I already have demonstrated the work of ID when we were checking whether a particular data is mutable or immutable. So it is same like that. If we can check it over here, if you remember, we had studied an identity operator, is and is not. So if I write a equals 5 and if I write b equals 5, let us check what it gives us. So I'm writing here a equals 5 and I'm writing b equals 5, and I write a is b. So it is true. Why? Because both a and b are pointing to the same memory location. So because it is pointing to the same memory location, so in the memory also there would be one copy of 5 to which a and b both are pointing to. So now if I write, okay, so here in this case, the difference between is and equal to would not be much. Like the result for a equals b, that is also going to be true. And if I write a is b, that is also true. But let us take the case of a list, which is a mutable data type. So we have a list here, that is, we have a. And a consists of these values 1, 2 and 3. So in the memory it would actually be containing three different pointers. This will point to 1, this will point to 2 and this will point to 3. And I also take b, which is also, and I assign b also as 1, 2 and 3. And I write b equals. So let us see what it gives us. So here I am writing a equals 1, 2 and 3, and then I write b also as 1, 2 and 3, and I write a is b. It is false. But if I write a equals b, it is true. Why? Because in the memory बी इज एक्चुअली पॉइंटिंग टू अ डिफरेंट लिस्ट ऑब्जेक्ट विच कंटेन्स अ टोटली डिफरेंट सेट ऑफ पॉइंटर्स वेयर ईच ऑफ द पॉइंटर्स आर पॉइंटिंग टू दीज मेमोरी लोकेशन बट द पॉइंटर लोकेशन आर डिफरेंट. दिस लिस्ट ऑब्जेक्ट माइट बी क्रिएटेड एट लोकेशन 1000 एंड दिस लिस्ट ऑब्जेक्ट माइट बी क्रिएटेड एट सम अदर लोकेशन. Let us check the location. If I write IDA, it is this. So I'm just going to copy this value and I'm going to print it. So you can see that the address of this list object is this. And if I just copy the ID, if I just write ID B, it will give me the ID for B. So this is the ID location for B. And this is the location for B. So you can see that both of these memory addresses are different. This is 576, this is 656. So these are, this is entirely different. 7395 8656 and 7402 4576. So entirely different memory locations. Hence, if I write A is B, the result is false because their identities or their locations are not the same. But if I write A equals B, that is true. Why? In it, this equality operator, it individually checks the checks each of the elements. That is, the first element here is 1, this is 1. Okay, move to the next one, this is 2, this is 2. Move to the next one, this is 3, this is 3. So number of elements is also the same, and the number and the elements are also the same. Hence, this result will give me true, whereas this first result will give me false. Why? Because this only works on the ID of the variables, whereas this works on the elements stored within the list. So students, this is the difference. This is how you can use the ID function to check the memory address of a particular variable. Now our next topic is, we will be writing a function, sorry, we will be writing a program to calculate simple and compound interest. So the program goes like this. Write a Python program to accept from the user, number one, principal amount, number two, interest, sorry, rate of interest, and number three, time period. Calculate and print number one, simple interest, and number two, compound interest. So this is a small program which we have to do today, where we will be writing a Python program to accept three things from the user. A principal amount, rate of interest, and time period. This will be the input. And we have to calculate and print simple interest and compound interest. What is the formula for simple interest? It is P into R into T divided by 100. And compound interest, it is this one. So you can see that it is P into R into T divided by 100. And here this is the formula for compound interest. Now we have to write a program where we can calculate both of them and print the result. So the only thing is, accepting values from the user is easy, that we can do it easily. Our first step is going to be input from user console. that is user is going to enter the value. Now you know that for calculating simple interest and compound interest, principal, rate, time, these three things are mandatory. You need these three things. So our input will be principal, rate and time period. Second is we have to apply the formula in the form of an expression, Python expression. How to do that? This expression can be converted in this form. P into R into T divided by 100. And this expression can be written as P multiplied by. See, there is nothing in between. It means multiplication. In pen and paper mathematics, it is allowed. But in case of Python or any programming language, you have to specify the operator. Then followed by 1 plus R divided by 100 raised to the power T and finally minus P. Now following the Bodmas rule, let us discuss these two expressions in the form of a Bodmas and we will see which of the values will be evaluated first. So we are coming to that. After applying it in the form of expression, finally what we are going to do is calculate, that is processing statement. These statements will form processing statements and the final step is going to be what? Print the values. Print the simple interest and compound interest, which is going to be the output. And output would be displayed where? On the monitor. So let's see how we can do it. So we will see how Bodmas rule will help us here. The first thing, that is simple interest, we already wrote it like this, P into R into T divided by 100. So Bodmas says that first bracket, then of, then division, multiplication, addition and subtraction. So in Python actually works, and not only Python, the other programming languages also work on the basis of operator precedence. So this is a small table which shows us the precedence of various operators, that is the priority of operators. So you can always take some time to take a look at it. At the highest, we have the exponentiation. So exponentiation has the highest priority. Hence, in an expression, whenever there are more than one operators, exponentiation will be executed first. Then we have unary positive, unary negative, and bitwise negation operator. Then we have multiplication, division, floor division and modulus operator. Now all those operators which are at the same level, it means they have the same operator precedence. But if in an expression we have more than one such operators which are at the same level of priority, then they will be executed from left to right. So here also we can see that multiplication and division, these are the operators which are there. So because they are at the same level of precedence, hence we will start solving them from the left hand side. So first of all, P into R will take place. Then whatever is the result, that will be multiplied to T. Then whatever is the result, that will be divided by 100. Same way if we consider compound interest. So we had already formed its expression. So in this expression, firstly, we have a multiplication here. So because bracket is there, so of course bracket will be considered first. So within this bracket, now what is there? 1 plus R divided by 10. So because division is there and plus is there. So we can see that plus has lower precedence than division. Hence division will be executed first. So first of all, we will be having R divided by 100. This will be evaluated first. Second, this value will be added to 1. So this is done. And afterwards, whatever value we have. Suppose this whole value evaluates to an intermediate value a. So p multiplied by a raised to the power t minus p. So now we have seen that exponentiation is that the higher level of precedence, highest level of precedence, hence this a into t will be evaluated first. That is, its order will be 3 now. Then you can see multiplication and division. So of course multiplication first. So this will be 4 and this one will be 5. So this is how a particular expression is going to be executed. So let us write the program, code the program and see for ourselves. So I am going to open a new window and I will save it. I will save it here in my Python programs. Simple and compound interest. .py. So I'm going to take first, I'm going to ask from the user principal. So because p, r, and t are the standard values used, hence here I am using simple p, r, and t. So normally value, that is principal amount, is considered as whole number. So I'm going to take int over here, enter the principal amount. R, that is rate of interest. So rate of interest I will be taking as float. So even if you are giving a whole number, it will be promoted to float by adding a 0.0 after that. And time period is usually in the form of whole numbers. So int. And now I'm going to calculate the simple interest. So that is going to be p into r, into t divided by 100. Then compound interest. Minus p. Now we'll print simple interest is equals to, just try printing the Indian rupee symbol. So no, I won't get it right now. Okay, so we can use the Unicode characters, so that I will tell you in a short while. So simple interest, and the simple interest over here will be SI. Next is print compound interest. CI. Save the program and now we will run it. So I'm going to reduce the size. So principal amount, if I enter as 20,000, rate of interest as 10.2% and time period as 5 years. So this is how I get the simple interest and compound interest. Now students, for using inserting the Indian rupee symbol here, which is of this form, we know that in Python all the strings are represented in the form internally, they are encoded in the form of Unicode characters. So Unicode is a system of coding and encoding and decoding character values, which includes all symbols of all languages of the world. So any number, any kind of character you can represent in a print statement. So the Unicode character for Indian rupee symbol is 20B9. This is the Unicode code for, or Unicode code point for, the Indian rupee symbol. And in Python I can use it along with an escape sequence character, that is slash u, which stands for insert a Unicode character. So I will write it this way, slash u 20B9. So let's do it and see. So here in place of rs dot, I'm going to write slash u 20B9. So So by looking at 20VB9, it should be clear to you that this is a hexadecimal code. Internally, because Unicode stores around more than 1 million characters of the world, hence we make use of hexadecimal codes such that the long or very long binary codes can be compressed into a small hexadecimal code, which is easier to handle and remember. So we can write /u20b9 over here. Let us run the program. Let's take some other value here. And yes, you can see that Indian rupee symbol is inserted over here. So this way you can make use of the Unicode characters to store any type of symbols. So students, here we end the class. We have discussed a lot about variables, their types, mutability, immutability, internal representation, and also we have seen a sample program. We also studied about the operator precedence. So it's my advice to everyone, you can create a small sheet where you can write the operator precedence, and every time you can refer to it while practicing, and slowly and gradually you will start memorizing them through practice. So keep practicing, keep learning, and keep watching my videos. Thank you all. Kindly like and share it with your friends if you like it. Thank you.